There's something special about working in a city like Detroit. It's a really abundant, rich ecosystem to work in.
So it says it is 70 meters this way.
Apparently, I look a little odd walking around Detroit with my backpack and my GPS, and people are like, yo, what are you doing? As an ecologist, I study species interactions. And working in this particular urban environment allows me to ask really cool questions about how wildlife is responding and adjusting in a human-dominated landscape and what type of human-wildlife conflicts could emerge. Ultimately, what we are trying to do is ensure some type of harmony for both wildlife and people sharing space together.
Detroit's modern history is not one steeped in wildlife. Its urban landscape was shaped by industry. For decades, America's Motor City thrived as the hub of U.S. car manufacturing. But when automation and foreign competition disrupted the industry in the mid-20th century, it faltered, and a local economic collapse soon followed.
Unlike other cities that have increased their population size over time, Detroit's population has actually gone down. In the 70s, it was about 1.2 million people that lived here. Today, it's about 700,000 people.
As factories closed and people left, entire neighborhoods fell into decay. By 2012, up to a third of the city had been abandoned. But it didn't remain empty for long. All across Detroit, wildlife has moved back in and made the city home. Some human residents have welcomed the change and even helped it along. The result is a new brand of city where humans and wildlife must learn to live together.
Detroit represents this amazing, complex, natural experiment. Wildlife modify their behaviors, their diets, and their activity patterns to live in urban environments.
Nyeema has studied wild creatures in cities and wilderness areas around the world.
But then I started to realize that there was an extra opportunity that I had working in urban environments to not only study carnivores, but also study their interactions with people. So the underlying theme of all of my projects is coexistence.
Carnivores are Nyeema's passion and the focus of her research. Her primary tool is a series of trail cams, which she's set up all across Detroit, from the suburbs to downtown.
We have cameras across 25 parks in the city. Sometimes it's literally a tree behind a basketball court. Sometimes you go into a really dense, thick forest and you forget that you're in Detroit. One of the hardest parts about the camera survey is like picking the right place. We've done a lot of work to scope out the areas, part of which we have to do is look for wildlife signs. Let's see if we can find any evidence of carnivores in the area.
Did you see these tracks down here?
These are raccoons. And they're literally like tight roping across the edge of the waterline here. That's very neat. We put the camera in a good location where animals are using the site. 739 pictures, 240 videos. So quite a nice amount of data.
Over the course of their study, Nyeema and her team have captured more than a million images of Detroit's wild residents, including red foxes, raccoons, and the city's top carnivore, the coyote. Each photo is an opportunity to see which creatures are here and a glimpse of what they're doing.
So we'll get it back to the lab, go through in more details, but we still have 40 more cameras to check.
Yep.
So this is just the beginning.
To complement the camera traps, Nyeema and her colleague Jane Hallam are also using a more high-tech approach, one that is revolutionizing conservation science. It's called environmental, or eDNA. This cutting-edge tool captures genetic traces that animals leave behind without ever having to come in contact with the animals themselves.
This is a bit like forensics. We're finding DNA in the environment, so it's literally coming from environmental samples like water or soil or, you know, scat or air even.
With eDNA, they can detect species that might have slipped past their camera traps, capturing traces of animals from days, weeks, or even years before. By collecting DNA fragments from soil and water samples around Detroit, they can compare these traces to known species and identify exactly which animals have been in the area. This technology is helping her build a richer, more complete picture of Detroit's wildlife and how the animals use the city.
We're looking at how animals move, how they're using the space, how that is affected by the seasons, how that interacts with people, and we're also adding to that data of what we're catching on the cameras.
Nyeema's team has identified 24 different mammal species within the city limits, suggesting a rich, diverse landscape and an ideal environment for opportunistic carnivores.
Earlier in the study, we had more sites where coyotes were not present. Now, coyotes are at almost all of our sites, which gives us some indication of perhaps that the population of coyotes has increased over the last 8 years.
Adaptable and resourceful, coyotes are settling into urban life. They're so elusive and keep so much to themselves that we often don't know they're around. And yet, encounters do happen. And the few that turn negative, of course, get the most attention.
Ultimately, what we are trying to do is ensure that the conflicts are minimized, not completely removed, because that's a utopia that doesn't exist. We have conversations about what people are seeing, what people are feeling, people loving coyotes and people hating coyotes.
These are important conversations, especially since coyotes are here to stay. And much like us, they're simply seeking a safe foothold in a complex urban environment.
Some of the coolest things we've seen out here have been some of the wildlife domestic species interactions, like dogs having possums in their mouth or dogs chasing coyotes, which is not what I would expect.
Dogs chasing coyotes turns the tables on the city's wild predators.
And so when you see an image of a German shepherd chasing off a coyote, it makes you rethink who actually is the top dog in the system.
And they may be having a bigger impact on the wildlife than we realize.
I'm trying to understand how sensitive the carnivores are to our activities.
Good boy. Let's go.
I got to this idea of, all right, what if I manipulate dog presence?
Good boy.
As a scientist, what do? You design an experiment.
For this one, Nyeema has enlisted some unlikely research assistants.
I partnered with the Michigan Humane Society and use shelter dogs. They get to frolic, they get to play, they get to go into natural environments.
Good boy.
At each site, the team compares wildlife activity on the camera before and after introducing the dogs, tracking which species show up, how often, and for how long.
Coyotes used to spend 30 minutes in the area, but now after the dog came, they only spend 3 minutes in the area. There's a shift in how they're using this area because of the increased dog pressure.
Ironically, it seems the dogs might be influencing the coyotes in much the same way coyotes and other predators influence their prey, an effect ecologists call the landscape of fear.
Just the mere presence of a carnivore can shape a prey species' behavior because there's an idea of fear.
Animals are constantly weighing risks, balancing their need to find food with the instinct to stay safe. This fear guides their behaviors, determining where they roam, how much they eat, and even when they're active. To better understand how Detroit's carnivores are navigating the trade-offs between risk and reward, Nyeema's running another experiment, serving up tempting treats with a side of danger.
What was that, fox, right?
Yeah, that was a fox.
They broadcast a range of sounds near the baits to see how the wild carnivores react.
These sounds simulate different types of potential risk.
Human.
You have people talking in the forest. You have kids playing. You have a dog barking. You have a wolf that you've never heard of and could be scary.
Most coyotes prefer to keep their distance from humans, sticking to back alleys and shadowy paths to avoid detection. But the study is revealing that not all members of a species react in the same way.
They're not all Wile E. the coyote. Instead, you have some that are shyer, some that are curious.
Oh, yeah, it's coming towards us.
The coyote!
Oh, no, the car.
Understanding how bold the carnivores are in the city really starts to help anticipate what type of human-wildlife conflicts could emerge. The shyer individual, that's probably not going to be the individual that comes to your backyard and interacts with your cat or dog.
But a bold carnivore might see your pets as rivals or food, and that can lead to conflict. But the outcome isn't inevitable.
We can modify our behaviors to minimize that conflict. How are you managing your own trash? Do your trash cans have lids on them? Those things have cascading effects on wildlife interactions that ultimately impact how much conflict exists within a city.
Nyeema's ongoing study in Detroit highlights simple steps to help people and wildlife share neighborhoods more peacefully. Keeping yards clean and removing pet food or trash can help prevent attracting carnivores, while supervising pets outdoors and choosing daytime walks keeps pets safe and reduces pressure on the wildlife.
Go away.
If a coyote gets a little too close,
go.
Even something as simple as clapping or shouting can encourage it to keep its distance.
Go away, go.
All of these need to be occurring in order to ensure that cities end up being vibrant, healthy ecosystems for our wildlife neighbors.
And that doesn't just benefit wildlife. It creates safer, more enjoyable spaces for all of us who share the city.
We've had this notion that you have to travel to some far distant land to experience the wonders of nature. But the reality is that we can experience those in our backyard. I hope that the research that we're doing in Detroit helps to build empathy for the wildlife neighbors, but I hope it also gives us insights about ourselves, our own levels of curiosity, our own levels of acceptance. We can learn a lot from the natural world if we're bold enough to open our eyes and open our hearts.
Thanks for watching this episode. If you'd like to dive deeper into this story or learn how you can help protect biodiversity near you, visit wildhope.tv. And come back on Mondays for more Wild Hope right here at PBS Nature on YouTube.